you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
Imagine there is a bank that credits your account each morning with $86,400. It carries over no balance from day to day. And every evening, it deletes whatever part of the balance you failed to use during that day. What would you do? Draw out every cent. Each one of us has such a bank. It's called time. Every morning it credits you with 86,400 seconds. And every night it writes off as lost whatever you have failed to invest wisely. It carries over no balance. It allows no overdraft. Each day it opens a new account for you. And if you fail to use the day's deposit, the loss is yours. There is no going back. There is no drawing against the tomorrow. You must live in the present on today's deposit. Invest it in every opportunity. The clock is running. You've got to make the most of today, right here, right now. To realize the value of 1 year, ask a student who failed a grade. To realize the value of 1 month, ask a mother who gave birth to a premature baby. To realize the value of 1 week, ask the editor of a weekly newspaper. To realize the value of 1 hour, ask a person who just missed a train. To realize the value of 1 second, ask a person who narrowly avoided an accident. To realize the value of 1 millisecond, ask the person who took the silver medal in the Olympics. Time waits for no one. Yesterday is history. Tomorrow is a mystery. Today is a gift. That's why it's called the present.
So today I want to share one of the most important messages I think I could ever share with you. Just before I do that, why don't you give someone a high five behind you, in front of you, to the side of you, high five behind, high five in front, high five below. Cool. So it's about time, in time, on time, and for such a time as this. We're looking at the gift of time. In other words, we're taking time for time. What you do with your time determines what time does with you. So important to make time count, not count on time. Today you've got 24 hours, 1,440 minutes, 86,400 seconds. It sounds like it's getting better, but it's not. It's the same amount of time. What are you going to do with those 86,400 seconds? Are you going to make every second count? How can we truly make time count and not count on time? I've got three keys. We're not going to do all three today. We're going to just do one. That's going to take us all morning to do. That's how big a subject this really is. You know, the Bible says in Psalm 90, verse 12, "So teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom." So the first point, the first key I really believe to making time count and not counting on time is to value time. How much do we value time? So it says to number our days. So I'm like, number our days. So you ever read scripture and you kind of go, number means to count, to calculate, right? So none of us really know how many days there are ahead. We don't know what tomorrow holds. We don't know how many days we've got left on the earth. But if we know who holds our days, we don't need to panic about that. But we do know how many days we've already lived. So what day number are you on today? See, I know what day number I'm on. I'm going to share it with you because I've counted and calculated my days. Now, if anybody knows how old I am, that took quite a long time. Today, I am 18,521 days old. Happy birthday to me. That sounds really old, doesn't it? All the young people sat there going, wow, that sounds really old. That's really old. I don't know whether I'll ever get that old. I've been a Christian for 13,048 days. I've been married for 10,556 days. I've been a father for 9,493 days, and it feels like just yesterday. I've been a pastor for 7,097 days. Wow, I'm old. See, when you realize figures like that, when you calculate, I just challenge you. It's really hard because you've got to work out all the leap years. Be all right if it was just 365. I mean, just times that by the amount of years you'd lived and you'd probably get there and but you've got to count in all those leap years, and trying to find out that information sometimes isn't that easy. But it makes you realize the significance of Psalm 139. It says this in verse 16. Like an open book, you watch me grow from conception to birth. All the stages of my life were spread out before you. The days of my life all prepared before I'd even live one day. It's amazing when we read that to realize there's not one day that isn't a significant day. We cannot waste a day because they're all significant. All our days were prepared. All our days were prepared in advance for us. God knew you were going to be here today. No shock to him, no surprise to him. He had it planned on the calendar. And, you know, when I read that all the stages of my life have been spread out, isn't that amazing to think that? How amazing God is to know everything about us. God knew that this week. I just want to share a little triumph with you, okay, because this is a big thing for me. Might not mean a lot to you. Hopefully it'll challenge you. But I ran 5K this week, and that's my personal best. I did about 12K, I think, altogether, or 12K altogether, which I'd really... So when I see on my phone, you know, I've now run 293Ks since I started running. That's a lot of Ks. I think they're doing Race for Life today. I don't know, is it 5K? So that's a lot of Ks, isn't it? 293. I think, wow, God even knew that I was going to get to the age of 50, and it was going to suddenly dawn on me that I needed to keep fit. In fact, I started to keep fit before I got to 50. I think it was the scariness of 50 that just went, oh, you're getting old now. You better just, you know, that weight isn't just going to go. I can feel my wife's voice still saying to me, well, until you do something about it. And, you know, you always answer back with, I know. But you know, you can eat all the right stuff, but you need to keep fit. I tell you what, I'd recommend it to anybody. Do I look forward to doing a 5K run? Not in the slightest. I do not wake up going, this is the day I'm going to go and run 5K. Hallelujah. I kind of go, oh, have I got to? Have I really got to? But I know that I'll feel good when I've done it. And I know that I've got to do something about my health, because if we're talking about the amount of days I've got left, I'm going to shock you in a minute to how many they reckon on average I have. And you might not be shocked because you might be younger than me, you might be older than me, and you're going to be even more shocked. But here's the deal, my dad died when he was 74. I am in my 51st year, so I'm 51 in September. So take 51 away from 74, how many do you have left? 23? That doesn't sound good. Now, No one's saying that I'm going to die the same age as my dad, but if I don't look after myself, some of these things are hereditary, and he died from heart failure, so I'm trying to keep my little ticker ticking. And I really believe God's put in our hands the ability to keep fit. Do we want to do it? No, not one of us want to do it. But do we want to live more days? Absolutely. I wouldn't think there's anybody here today that wants to die, because we want to live. There's so much to live for. So when we realize that, you know, our days have been appointed, God has given us something to do. You know, I thought I was going to do everything when I was young. And now as you get older, you think, oh, I haven't got much time to get it all done now. But we're going to get it done. And that's why I want to stay fit and healthy and as young as I can in my spirit so that I can get it done. I've already proved to you how old I am today. I even forgot to pray for the students within 5 minutes. So that's going already. So I got to keep this going. But we're not here just for a season. We're here for a reason. We're not here to survive. We're here to thrive. We're not here to make a living. We're here to live a destiny. Each day appointed, purposed. You know, another thing that occurs when you start to value time is you realize exactly what the psalmist was saying when he was talking about how brief our time on earth really is. Psalm 39 verse 4, Lord, remind me how brief my time on earth really is. Remind me that my days are numbered, how fleeting my life is. You've made my life no longer than the width of my hand. My entire lifetime is just a moment to you. At best, each of us is but a breath. Now listen, I want to just say that the psalmist was not being this manic depressive. He hadn't got up one day and gone, oh dear, my life is just not worth living because I'm just going to be over before I've even started. He was just saying, God, just remind me every day that I wake up is a gift. Don't let me go through today just believing I've got all the days I need to just do whatever I want to do. Because I tell you what, life does really creep up on you. He was really saying, remind me of time. Remind me that my days really are numbered. The psalm ends with a Selah. It means to pause, to reflect. Oh, how we need to constantly be reminded to pause and reflect on time. We need a reality check. You see, this is not a warm-up. In the words of another famous Michael, this is it. And it was for that Michael, because just after he made that comment, that statement, just before June the 25th, 2009, Michael Jackson's life ended at the age of 50 years, 9 months, and 27 days. I want to encourage you to value the time you have left. Who knows how much that is? But I want to just give you an average today. I hate averages, and I'm praising God I'm not average. Neither are you. You don't need to be average. So these figures are not really relative. We'll go for the higher figure rather than the lower figure, hey? So if I'm 18,521 days old, the chances are I have, on average, somewhere between 7,064. Now, that really doesn't sound good. To 17,979 days to live. That still doesn't sound good. Because looking at those figures, I've already lived then longer than I've got time to live. It's now tipped. I've lived 18,521, and maybe at best, well, you see, I'm believing I will go on to 120, so we'll be all right. But just in case I don't, just for this illustration, can you imagine me at 120? Still running, still doing the weights, ooh, holding me Zimmer. 17,979, that still isn't good because it's on the other side now. I want to tell you something, time doesn't stand still. It really, truly flies. You know all those sayings you hear? You just think they're cute sayings and then you realize they're true. Time doesn't stand still. The hours are passing by. The minutes are ticking away. The seconds are disappearing fast. There's another one. There's another one. I'm watching the clock on here. It's gone. We're never going to see that one again. Oh, that's 5 seconds. So those 86,400 seconds are ticking away. Time waits for no one. Doesn't matter who you are. Waits for no one. I love what it said in that video. Yesterday is history. Tomorrow is a mystery. Today is a gift. That's why it's called the present. Isn't that awesome? It is a gift. Do you ever wake up in the morning and say, thank God I'm still breathing. I've got another day to make a difference. Another day to live God's best. Every time you say, just a minute, don't we always say that? Just a minute. Do you realize you lose it? Just a minute. Come. Reality is, each hour of each day, we're all a little older. The psalmist said in Psalm 37, verse 25, once I was young, and now I am old. I like the way the message puts it. Once I was young, now I am a gray beard. Oh, yes, I know that feeling too. Men, it's going to get very uncomfortable any second now, okay? Just hold on to your seats. It's true. How one day you can feel like you're so young and the next day, where did those days go? Now you're feeling old. If I was writing the Bible, I'd go, wow, what a difference a day makes. In just one day, I seem to have gone gray. Because that's how quick it happens. If you don't believe what the psalmist was saying is true, one day you will. Let me tell you, your day will come. Because time waits for no one. Guys, particularly, maybe ladies, this is relevant, but I'm going to just talk to the guys. You will be very, very interested in a new aisle in Boots the Chemist. It's called the hair products. Down that aisle, you'll be searching out these three products, and there might be more, but I know every single one of them, just for men. Grecian 2000, can you imagine? They'd still make that. Restoria. Oh, I know them because I've been there, done that. In fact, did it for a while, realized that my hair grows so quickly I can't keep up with it. So my wife would dye my hair and I'd have this little tufty bit at the front here, which always gave me away that it was gray. And it was like, you know, you dye my hair and within 24 hours I got the gray again. I just decided in the end, you know what, I can't keep up with this. Plus the fact I'm starting to look like some aging American. And for my American friends watching, if you dye your hair, I love you all, but I wasn't referring to you right then. And you know, that first gray hair seems so mortifying, but I want to tell you, it's okay. You'll get over it. You'll have to. And you know, people do try and make you feel better when you realize that you've got gray hair and that possibly is a sign that you're getting a bit older. And they start quoting Proverbs 16:31. Gray hair is a mark of distinction, the award for a God-loyal life. Yeah, like that makes me feel any better. Or they share Proverbs 20:29. Youth may be admired for vigor, but gray hair gives prestige to old age. That's like referring to me as some old car. You know, we all know new cars are nice. Who wants an old car? Even though they look nice, they are prestige, you know, but it's something about a new car, isn't there? It's okay, guys, because our friends, and suddenly they will become friends, George Clooney, got you ladies' attention, didn't I then? And Matt LeBlanc, because he's the more recent one. Anybody seen him on television this week? They're making gray hair trendy. And if Joey can be gray, we can all be gray. Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. Go and watch Friends. Gray is now trendy. In fact, when I was doing research for this, I could not believe what I read. And that is Kelly Osbourne actually has dyed her hair gray. Because she used to think as a kid, her auntie, who went gray very young, looked so amazing with gray hair. So she thought, how cool that would be. Well, if you're going to be an Osbourne, you know, the Osbournes do really weird things. I'm sure they're a lovely family, but Listen, they're going to be out there a little bit, aren't they? So she's dyeing her hair. So I'm thinking, oh, grey's trendy now. That's all right. We're okay. But you know, just when you've got to that stage of accepting that your hair colour is never going to be that ever again, because you know, it doesn't matter what Restoria says, it's always going to be the colour that you're going to move on to, you then face your next mortifying moment. I'm sorry, guys, I'm painting this real negative picture. I just want you to be real. And, you know, the next mortifying moment is one day you look in the mirror and you see something called fine lines. Now, I don't know why. Anybody tell me why they call it fine lines? There's nothing fine about it. Fine lines. They aren't fine. I was much better without them. Let's give you a couple more. Can you take a couple more? Come on, you guys are strong and brave. And because one day, the real, real shocker comes. You're kind of going about your daily routine, and you're just dealing with the fine lines, and you're dealing with the gray hair, and suddenly you turn to walk out the bathroom or out of your bedroom, and you're looking in the mirror, because you do look a lot more as you grow older, because you're kind of inspecting what's going on. Or maybe you just, you know what you do, you touch your skin, and then you put your hand up by your ear, and you discover that a forest is growing. A forest is growing in my ear. You know, the fact is, we're going to be forever fighting something that naturally is going to happen. We're going to get old. Turn to your neighbor and say, we're going to get old. Unfortunately, we don't always get impacted enough to appreciate life. So what God allows to happen is shock moments closer to home. Maybe the loss of a loved one, maybe a medical emergency, maybe a health threat, maybe we're even in or experience a near-death experience. God doesn't send those times to, you know, panic us. I don't want anybody going away today panicking about life, panicking that, you know, our life is going to be taken. But let's at least be in a place where we're valuing life today and living it to the full. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life. So God is not about taking away our lives. He's about giving us more life, because Jesus went on to say, life like you've never experienced it before. I want to just challenge you, because even the greatest shock moments are so short-lived. Like if we saw news today about something that's happened in the world, would it shock us enough to make a difference, to live differently, to appreciate and value time, to live tomorrow like we've never lived before, to live with an attitude of gratitude every day that you wake up, saying, thank you, God, for this simple, simple thing that I can breathe. Because it is a gift. Life is a gift. I think what we've got to quit saying is one day. But you know what? One day, the only way that one day is ever going to come your way is if you make it 2 days. And there is a time when one day becomes 2 days.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.